Lord, I pray as we look into this word, let it bless every soul. Let it bless everyone that will hear your words this morning in the name of Jesus. Make your words simple and clear. Give understanding. Open our eyes, enlighten our eyes of understanding to see what we need to apply to our individual lives to be a better person in Jesus' name. Take control. Let your grace be released upon everyone. In the mighty name of Jesus, we have prayed. Amen. The 3D ingredients of purpose, part 1. Diligence and dexterity is what we're going to be looking at today. And let's read Proverbs chapter 22, verse 29. Very popular verse. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 29. Proverbs 22, verse 29. I will start with the KJV, but we are going to go through some versions this morning just to understand what that verse is saying. Okay? I know if you're holding just one Bible, you might not be able to see the other versions. But you can, if you have a phone, you can also try to change your versions. Okay? So, Proverbs chapter 22, verse 29, KJV. Seest thou a man diligent in his business? He shall stand before kings. He shall not stand before mean men. Seest thou a man diligent? Now, I want us to focus on that word diligent. Diligent. Let's see NLT version. What that word could be or what was replaced with that word. In NLT version, it said, do you see any truly competent workers? So, you see that diligence have been replaced with truly competent. So, do you see any truly competent workers? They will serve kings rather than working for ordinary people. Let's see the New King James Version. New King James Version. It says, do you see a man who excels in his work? So, diligence, we started with diligent in KJV. NLT says truly competent. Now, New King James Version is saying who excels in his work. I don't think they are the same thing, but they are related. Diligence, competent, excellence. You see, so that word itself, we are seeing what the interpreters are using, the words they are using to interpret that real word. So we have diligence, we have truly competent, excels, excellence. AMP version says, did you see a man skillful and experienced in his work? So when we are talking about diligence, we are also looking at somebody that is skillful and somebody that is experienced in what he does. He said he will not stand in honor before kings, it will stand before obscure men. AMP and NIV are very similar. So you also see in NIV, diligence there is replaced by skilled, skills. He said, do you see someone skilled in their work? So, just by reading these different versions, we can have a glimpse of what we mean by diligence, right? So, we started with diligence, then we looked at truly competent, somebody who excels in his work, somebody who is skillful, somebody who is experienced. So, that's why I read those different versions. So, we have a bigger picture of that word diligence. But if you ask me what is diligence, I would say diligence is the quality that involves persistent effort and attention to detail. Diligence is a quality that involves persistent effort and attention to detail. And diligence is characterized by different things. The first thing I will say that qualifies diligence is hard work. And what is hard work? Is putting your best in what you do. Putting your best in what you do. Hard work is not working hard, okay? Hard work is making sure your effort is distributed in the right places. So there are many people who are working so hard, but little results is being shown, okay? They are working hard, but they are not hard working. So hardworking is ensuring you are using the best method to achieve the best result. Some people will say hard work is actually smart work. Hard work is using smart methods to achieve best results. So it's not about exerting energy. It's not about exerting effort. It's knowing how to apply those efforts to yield the right result, the result that you are looking for. That is hard work. Because if you are doing something, if you are working hard, so to say, and you are not seeing results, hard work will speak to you in such that diligence will speak to you in such that you will look for what is wrong and try to channel your efforts and energy into the right places so that you can achieve the right results. So the first thing about diligence is hard work. Hard work. The second thing is attention to detail. It's being careful in what you do. Now, attention to detail does not have anything to do with smartness. There are many smart people who do not pay attention to details. You know that. There are many smart people who don't pay attention to details. And I remember I give this example a lot, and it happened to somebody very related to me. You see a surgeon. Surgeons are smart people, but they operated on this my relative, and after the operation, they forgot a swab inside the body of the patient. You know what a swab is? It's a small clot they have that used to clean off, you know, whether the blood, and they forgot the swab. All right, until she became sick. And her body, the infections in her body, and they were trying to look for what is going on. And by the time they searched, they saw that they forgot a swab. They forgot something in her body. So the surgeons are smart, but they were not paying attention to details. So that is not diligence. You understand? They were not diligent. So diligence is not about hard work only. It's also about paying attention to details. What else characterizes diligence is responsibility. Responsibility. You are taking charge of your life and work. You are taking responsibility of your life. That is diligence. If you want to be diligent, okay, you take responsibility of what has been given to you. You don't pass blames. You don't say, oh, it's as a result of my parents. It's because my parents gave birth to me. Yeah. It's because my parents did not give me money. It's because my parents did not go to school. It's because my parents do not do this. No. When you are diligent, you don't make excuses. You don't blame other people for your own life. You take responsibility of your life. You don't say, oh, it's because my brothers will not allow me to read, or my sisters will not give me space, or they didn't give me food. Or you don't even, you know, some students even blame their teachers for their negligence. Okay? They blame their teachers. It's because my teacher is not good. It's because my teacher is not teaching well. That is why I'm not passing this exam. That is not being diligent. Okay? Being diligent, you take responsibility. I remember when I was in my graduate school, right? There is one doctor that that teaches us this subject in statistics. I know statistics can be difficult on its own. Then when you don't have a good teacher, it becomes worse. It becomes really bad. And she was taking us on this course, experimental designs. It's very deep course. One, we can't hear well. Our voice is so tiny. Her voice is so tiny. Then she can't speak English very well. Okay. But when she sets the exam, oh my God. You will be like, oh, this woman does not speak well, but her exam is conk. Her exam is deep. You understand? She doesn't care. She doesn't care. She comes to class, speaks with a tiny voice, right on the board. If you see it, fine. If you don't see it, it's okay. And she teaches her syllabus or whatsoever is in her book, and that is it. Now, will I keep complaining and say, because this lady is not speaking well, so because of that, I'll fail the exam? Is that what I'm going to do? No, I have to take responsibility. Yes, she's not speaking well. She's not teaching well. This course is difficult. You know, she doesn't speak English well, but I have to pass, right? then I have to work hard. I have to be diligent, not passing the blame to her. So people will just sit down and say, well, it's not my fault. It's because she's not speaking English well. That is why I failed the exam. No, nobody cares. It means you are not diligent. You don't give excuses. You don't pass blames to others. So diligence, again, is characterized by hard work, by attention to details, and by responsibility. So if you want to know somebody that is diligent, those are the three things you can use to assess them. How hardworking are they? Do they pay attention to details? And if you've gone into business, you see sometimes they will always say, do your due diligence. Have you heard that word before? Due diligence. That means you should pay attention to details. Pay attention to details. And then you take responsibility for what you are doing. So the first thing I said we'll talk about diligence. The other thing is dexterity. What is dexterity? Dexterity is the physical ability to use your skills to excellently perform a specific task. Dexterity is the physical ability to use your skills to excellently perform a specific test. So, a task. Dexterity is characterized by what? By quickness. You are able to do things quickly. You are not too slow. You are quick at completing your task. And I don't mean you are rushing to do your task. You are quick at completing your task. You are steady and you are following a very healthy pace to complete your task. You are not slothful. So that's why Paul said, not slothful in business. And you know where that word slothful came from? It came from the word sloth. And you know sloth, sloth is a very slow animal. Very slow animal. They sleep about 15 to 20 hours in a day. Sloth, okay? I remember when we visited one of those, is this zoo? Now, and we saw sloth, and they were saying it takes hours. The sloth will have to come down from the tree to defecate. And if they take hours just to defecate, it will come down slowly. Hours just to defecate. So that's why Paul said, not slothful in business. If you're somebody that has dexterity, you do your stuff quick. You're not rushing it, but you are quick at it. You are not slow at it. Dexterity is also characterized by excellence. Excellence. You see all the versions we read. You see, seest thou a man diligent? Seest thou a man who excels in his work? So that diligence there was actually talking about diligence and dexterity. It has much to do with skill and excellence. Not all skillful people are excellent. Do you know that? Not all skillful people are excellent. Skill comes with knowledge and experience, but excellence comes with paying attention to details. Paying attention to details. I remember when I was in school, I used to be very good in mathematics, right? I used to be very good in mathematics. But I was not always the best. I was not always at the top. You know why? Because I don't pay attention to details. My friend, the other guy, is also good, but he always comes ahead of me. Why? Because he pays attention to details. I'm better than him in mathematics. I teach him sometimes, but he does well in exams than I do. Okay? Why? Because sometimes I will look at a place 4 plus 4, 6, 4 times 4, 16, right? Instead of me to write 16, I write 6. I forget the 1. Okay, I forget the one because I'm trying to be quick. And you know, this kind of equations where one leads to another one leads to another one. So if you get 6 in this place, it will affect the next answer, and it will affect the next answer, and the last answer will be wrong. You understand? So when I get my results, sometimes I'm like, why did I fail this? I got it. Then I trace it back to that place. Instead of me to write 16, I wrote 6. That's the difference between me and this other guy. This other guy, even if he has finished his work, he will pay attention to details. He will go back and see what he was doing, right? And he can even catch the mistake before he submits and corrects everything. You understand? So I might be skillful, but I'm not excellent. You understand? I was not doing excellently well because I was not paying attention to details. You understand what I mean? So dexterity is not just about being skillful. It's also about paying attention to details, being excellent in what you do. All right? Another thing that characterizes dexterity is precision. Precision. The quality of being accurate. Accurate. And if you're talking about, if you want to think about precision, think about surgeons who have, look, remember Ben Carson? Do you know Ben Carson? He was a very renowned surgeon. Think about him trying to divide the twins. The brain, right? Those conjoined twins are the brain. He has to be very careful. He has to be precise. No mistake, you understand? The margin of error should be very low, because if he does anything mistakenly, he can rupture the artery, can rupture the vein, he can rupture the nerves, he can destroy, because the brain is delicate. So you can imagine the level of precision he needs. So when you see people who have high precision, or people that we say have dexterity, they have high precision in what they do. They are accurate in what they do. So in fact, and that's, it also affects, if you read precision is a deep topic in some courses, and that's what they use to make him, for example, pregnancy test has to be precise. Okay, it means it has to tell you it's positive. You might have negative, false negative, yeah, it's okay, but the false positive must be low, because if the pregnancy test says somebody is not pregnant and the person is pregnant, or if it says the person is pregnant, right, false positive, and the person is not pregnant, there's trouble. Imagine somebody say you are pregnant. Look at the joy. They will jump up. In fact, some people will buy a house. The test says I'm pregnant. They will buy a house. They will buy a car. They will buy everything. And later they said, what happened? Nothing is happening. I'm not seeing any changes in my body. But the test said I'm pregnant. So that is why pregnancy tests are always precise. They have high precision. But in our lives, in what we do, if you want to be a man or a boy or a girl of dexterity, you must have precision. Okay? You will try as much as possible to be always accurate in what you do. To be always accurate in what you do. Going back to when I was in medical school, there was this guy too I know. His level of precision is so high. You know, we do a lot of multiple choice questions, right? Choose A and B. And the truth is, there are sometimes you have to guess. And in medical school, there is a lot of negative marking. I don't know if you've heard of negative marking before. So if you don't know the answer, don't pick it. Leave it blank. For every wrong answer you pick, there will be a negative mark applied. So it's either negative 0.5 or negative 1. So sometimes, if it's minus 1, for every question you get wrong, minus 1, it means if you get 50 questions out of 100 and you get 50 questions right, what is your mark? Zero, right? 50 minus 50 is zero. Okay? So in medical school, when you are doing multiple choice questions, you have to be precise. And they tell you, if you don't know the answer, leave it blank. All right? Or if they want to, you know, pity us sometimes, they say, okay, instead of minus 1, minus 0.25. Okay? But you know, you don't know all the answers, so sometimes you need to take a guess. Okay? But this boy is so good at taking the guesses, and his guesses are always almost right. And he came out, in fact, he's the best graduating student in our set. Because I don't know this answer, but I guess it's B, and that B will be correct. You understand? That is high precision. That I would say that boy has good dexterity in those subjects. You understand what I mean? So when I'm talking about diligence and dexterity, I said, is characterized by quickness, by excellence, and by precision. Examples of people in the Bible, two examples that are very common and really applies to this is David. David, the Bible says David, he chose David in Psalm 78, verse 70 to 72. He guided them by the skillfulness of his hand. So David was skillful, David was diligent, and David had dexterity. You understand? Imagine David missing the head of Goliath, that first shot. Imagine what would have happened. Just imagine. So David was so precise. I know, well, the Holy Spirit backed it up, but he has practiced it over and over. That is where his hard work came. He has done his due diligence. And now it was time to face Goliath. He took the stone and he ate it. It went exactly where it should go. And this is not without Goliath putting on a helmet, because from the stories we read and everything, Goliath was well dressed up as a soldier. So I'm sure he had his headgear and everything. But David was very precise. Daniel was also very precise in his interpretation of dreams. Imagine if every time they called Daniel to interpret dreams, his dreams were wrong. They would have killed him. That's every time we call you to interpret dreams, you are not accurate with this. You say, okay, king, I'm sorry. I got one part partially, but this one I got it well. They would have killed Daniel all the while. But the reason why Daniel was able to sustain himself through different regimes and different reigns of kings was because he was accurate. He had diligence and dexterity in what he does, even in the interpretation of dreams, right? He was good at it. And that is why I'm encouraging every one of you to be diligent and have dexterity in what you do. The question is, how can you be diligent? Two things I would say here. One, you must have discipline. You must have the self-control to focus on what is your hand on the moment. At the moment, have the self-control to focus on what is your hand at the moment. Have the self-control to focus on what is your hand at the moment. You must be disciplined. Avoid distractions. Distractions that are coming from your body, because as young people, as you grow, you know, your hormones are working, and your hormones are making you feel in different ways, and you are attracted to girls, you are attracted to boys, and a lot of feelings, a crush, infatuation, love, all these things are coming together. You have to be careful. Don't allow those things to distract you, especially if you're in school, if you're in college, you are studying, you have so much to study. Don't allow these things to distract you. I walked around the college nearby us here on Wednesday, and I see most of the people, you know, they're just going around. It's more about relationship, my boyfriend, my girlfriend, and all these things, and that's what they spend all their time on when you are in school. You know, there is time for everything, right? There is time for everything. There is a time, yes, when you have to love. When you love, you need to love somebody. You need to get married. But if you're just a freshman in school, I mean, you need to focus on things that will help you in life. So, discipline. Don't allow your hormones to get hold of you. Don't allow games to get hold of you. Because there's a way you can play games and you are distracted. I know somebody who came in, who got admission with a scholarship. Everything was going on until he stumbled on the game. And by the time he started playing those games, he played it and played and played. The more he played, the more his GPA was dropping. So the hours of game playing was inversely proportional to his GPA, right? It was inversely proportional to his GPA. So that is why you have to be careful. Don't allow games to take hold of everything you are doing. Be careful. Be careful of social media, because that is another thing that distracts us. Even for me, you can be surprised. You can be on social media for 1 hour without knowing. You are just scrolling, you are watching, and your body is enjoying it. Your body is enjoying it because we love entertainment. So be careful of social media. Be careful of watching movies over time. You understand? I'm not saying you should not watch movie, but don't allow it to take all your time. Be careful of friends, because your friends too can distract you. Oh, anytime you want to pay attention and do your due diligence in your work and everything, that is when your friend is calling you, let's go to one party. Then, you postpone your assignment to tomorrow. Then tomorrow comes, and your friend calls you again. Let's go to one bar. Then you postpone your assignment to the next day. Then another one comes, your friend comes again. Oh, let's visit town. You see, your friend is distracting you until when it's 2 hours to the assignment, 11:59, right? So that's when it's always due. Then you start rushing. That is not good enough. So don't allow friends to distract you. So you need that discipline. The other thing you need is determination. You have to be determined that no matter what, it's not going to be easy. Studying is not easy. That's the truth. Most courses you do in college, in high school, in middle school will not be easy, will not be straightforward. But you have to be determined. Don't allow failure. You fail, you rise up, you walk again. Don't allow your family background to hinder you. Don't even allow financial issues to hinder you. Yes, don't allow financial issues to hinder you. You make up your mind that you are going to succeed. You are going to push forward. You are going to finish it. My parents might not have the means to finish it, to pay for me, but I'm going to make it. Hallelujah. You have to push forward. I always like to tell this story. I remember when I came to the United States, I came with only $400. Because I was sponsoring myself. I've used all the money I made when I was working to pay for exams, pay for everything, to buy the flights to come. So when I came into the United States, I only had $400. And the pastor that was lodging me there, he called me one day and asked, because I was looking for accommodation. The $400 cannot even pay for accommodation. When he asked me, so how much do you have? I said, $400. I saw his facial expression. I knew I was in trouble. Because how will I pay for? I need to pay for rent. My school fees is $16,000, right? And because I didn't have any assistantship, I didn't have any scholarship. How was I going to pay for all that? $400. But when I left him, I went into his room. I was eavesdropping what he was saying to his wife. One thing he said, well, I don't know how this boy is going to do it, but I see that he's determined. So you must show that determination. And God made a way. Hallelujah. God made a way. Now till today, I don't know how. If you tell me, how did you do it? I can't explain to you. I was able to finish the master's. I finished my master's by God's grace. Finished my PhD by God's grace. And I came with only $400. I know God sent helpers. God sent different things. And God was leading me and guiding me in all the way. How? God's grace. But diligence. You understand? Hard work, dexterity, determination that you cannot give up. I cannot go back. In fact, few months after I came, people are telling me, oh, it's like you need to go back. You have already lost your admission. You've lost everything. You cannot pay your school fees. Just carry your bag and go back home. And then I started thinking, did I give my resignation letter where I left? Maybe I should not have submitted a resignation letter. I was already thinking how to go back. But another thing came. Don't go back. Come on. Be determined. You can finish it. Hallelujah. You can finish it. It's not always easy on the road, but you can finish. You can finish what you've started. And if God is with you, you will finish in Jesus' name. How do you develop dexterity? Number one, identify your potential. Know your skills. Find out what you know how to do well. If I ask you now, what are your skills? What do you know how to do well? David knew he could play the harp. David knew he could write songs. Daniel knew he could interpret dreams. Peter knew he could talk. Okay? Paul knew he could debate. What can you do? Do you know how to analyze? Do you know how to make people see something from a set of information? Are you creative? Do you know how to make something out of little? Are you an administrator? Do you know how to organize to bring out the beauty out of something? You should look for something you know how to do. Don't try to copy other people. Trying to be like someone else can mask your uniqueness and your possibilities. So know, identify your skills, identify your potentials. That's the first thing you should do. Then number two, you make a plan. How do I improve these skills now? Because skills are just like raw materials. If you don't improve on them, if you don't develop them, they will just remain there. Some people are very skillful. They know how to sing. They know how to play. They know how to draw. But you can tell that they are still raw. The talent is there. The skill is there. But there is no development. So you have to make a plan. How do I develop my skill? What exposure do I need? Where do I need to go? Which people do I need to talk to? Okay, I knew how to play the violin very well. I was skillful. They taught me when I was young. But I know I had to develop. At a point, I was not going higher. Where I was, I thought I was the best. But when I exposed myself to another set of people, I became, I was number 10. I was number one, yeah. Okay, number one position. Then when I changed my environment and exposed myself, I went from number one to number 40. So I saw other people who knew how to play better than me. I humbled myself. I cringed under the table. I'm like, gosh, I thought I knew how to play violin. No. Because I exposed myself. So you have to make plans to expose yourself. Make plans to expose yourself. Then it will help you develop your skill. Then after making plans, you execute the plan. Because it's one thing to have a plan. It's another thing to execute the plan. Many people have plans, but only few people act on those plans. People who make a difference in the world are those who act on their plans. Those who act on their plans. So you need to act on your plan. Like that, like what I told you, after I saw that I was not where I needed to be, I said every Sunday I will practice my violin for 2 hours. That was a plan. And I started doing it. Every Sunday, 2 hours. I'm playing different classical songs, trying to improve my skills. Then that brings me to consistency. You have to be consistent because if you want to grow, you have to keep doing it every day. If you want to grow, you want to develop, you need to do it continuously. You have to be consistent. For example, and the truth is that when you are consistent, you might not see the result immediately, but your consistency will bring the result after a while. So, for example, when we eat, we don't really observe we are growing, right? But we just know after a while, we see yourself, you have grown. Why? We eat every day. Consistent. You understand? We are consistent. Those accumulation of the consistent times is what bring the growth. We don't just eat once in a week and stop. We will not grow. You understand? We eat every day. Because we are consistent in eating, automatically, we don't even need to think about it, we grow. Right? We develop. The same thing in what you do. Anything you want to do, you just have to be consistent. Every day, 30 minutes. Or every week, 1 hour. Consistency. You do it continuously. Do it continuously. You think you are not growing, but you are actually growing. It's people that will tell you, wow, you have grown. You understand? Because you are being consistent. Hallelujah. So that's what I'm talking about today, diligence and dexterity. Next week, we are going to focus a little bit more on determination. But today is diligence and dexterity. And look at what the Bible says. It said that, seest thou a man diligent in what he does, he will stand before kings. That is the result. You will stand before people of value. You will stand before people who will make national or global decisions. You will stand before people who can enhance the progress in your life. So that is why you need to be diligent and have dexterity. And I pray as you do this, the Lord will bless you. The Lord will raise you up. The Lord will take you higher in the mighty name of Jesus. And imagine having diligence and having dexterity and then God backing you up. Wow, you will be a mighty force. That's what happened to David. He was a mighty force. He was diligent. He had dexterity in what he did. Then the Holy Spirit now backed him up. Okay? The G factor. That's what I call it. The G factor was there for him. He was a mighty force. A mighty force. He stood not before only kings. He himself became a king. Hallelujah. Because he had these qualities. And I pray for every one of you that you will develop these qualities in the mighty name of Jesus. And as we round up, let me just plead with those that have not given their life to Jesus. You might have dexterity, you might have diligence, but if you don't have God, you cannot go to the place where God wants you to be. So I plead with you, if you have not given your life to Jesus, surrender your life to Jesus. Give your life to Jesus. Let him have mercy on you. Let him forgive your sins. Let him cleanse every unrighteousness, and your life will be changed totally in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are going to sing this song, "Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow." Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow. If you are not born again, just bow your head right now and say, "Lord, forgive me of my sins. Lord, I recognize that I can have everything in this world, but without you, I am nobody. I pray that you come into my heart. I accept you as my personal Lord and Savior. And by the time you are added to all these qualities that I need to have, I believe I will be that person you want me to be, in the mighty name of Jesus." If you have prayed that prayer, I want you to believe in your heart that Jesus is your Savior. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is your Savior, and you will never remain the same, in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I can face tomorrow because He lives. All fear is gone because I know He holds my future. My life is worth a living just because He lives. Let me pray for you as we go. I pray that the Lord will give you the grace to be diligent. I pray the Lord will give you the grace to do what you have to do. I pray the Lord will give you the grace to pay attention to details. I pray the Lord will give you the grace to imbibe these qualities in everything that you do, in the mighty name of Jesus. And like we are reading about the testimony of David and Daniel, people will read about us in the future, and they will see that the Lord is good, and they will use us for examples unto others on how to be diligent and how to have dexterity, in the mighty name of Jesus. Bless our week, O Lord. Let the peace of God that passeth understanding be upon everyone, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you. God bless you, and have a great week. Hallelujah. Thank you for listening to this message. I hope you were blessed. If you were blessed, please subscribe to this channel so you can get more of our content. Please share to your friends and families, and please support this ministry by going to our website and clicking on the Give menu. I pray as you do so, the Lord will bless you, and the Lord will continue to increase you and give you peace on every side. God bless you. Bye.